بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، نحمده ونصلي على رسول الكريم. So for the last two weeks we've started the point forms of the adab that pertain to particular situations. And today we'll go back one or two points. Today is the chapter on how to relieve oneself, the adab, what is also known as istinja. And we should not take any of these lightly, because especially in the matter of cleanliness, because our salah is precipitated, is preconditioned by wudu, and our wudu is a condition on the fact that we clean ourselves properly also at the proper time, in the proper way. Because when we establish the conditions before the salah, so sometimes I'll just throw in one or two fiqh issues, but like I said, this is not a class of fiqh or hadith, it's a class of adab, how to do things in certain situations. So remember that prior to the salah, there are seven conditions. Three of them, when we teach our children, we say the first three begin with the word clean. So clean body, clean place, and clean clothes. So if you don't have a purity of body, in other words, you don't have wudu, or the place is not clean, or there's some najasa, in other words, impurity on your clothes, your salah will not be accepted. You know? And it may seem easy, but the kids fall for this one a lot. I say that let's say you have wudu, like we all have now, and a dog licks you. Does your wudu break? And they all say yes. Right? Because they all know that there's something not right. You know, dog saliva is najas, it's najis. And I say, can you make salah? They say, no, you can't make salah. So your wudu breaks. I say, yes. They say, yes, your wudu breaks. But it's actually the second or the third condition. In other words, the dog has licked you on your clothing, right, or your skin. But actually, in actuality, wudu only breaks when something comes out of your body. Blood, urine, stool, vomit, pus, like that, right? That's a general rule. So if a person has not relieved himself properly and he's got najasa on his body and clothes, he may make an excellent wudu, but his salah still won't be counted because he has not fulfilled the other conditions, which are purity or cleanliness of body and place. And the others are qibla, facing the proper way, the time for salah, and covering the satr or the awra as whatever is mandated, depending on man or woman, and the niyyah. A Muslim should enter the lavatory with his left foot, and prior to entering, he should say, Allahumma or Bismillah, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-khubuthi wal-khaba'ith. O Allah, I seek protection from the khubuth and khaba'ith. What are khubuth and khaba'ith? That's in a class of fiqh. Just say from the major and minor impurities. Number two, one should not go in the lavatory in company, nor seek it therein. But it should be very private, and a person should not uncover his private parts except when there's no one. So, for example, if the door is closed, like how we have our modern lavatories system, right? But what pertains here is that he says, under no circumstances should you go into a men's restroom where and how they just stand next to each other. That is not only is it bad adab, but it falls in the category of the haram. Number three, a person should enter and he should go into the lavatory not with unprotected feet. He should wear some slippers. And I know in masjids they have them, but sometimes you go into a place where you know you've taken off your shoes, but they haven't made any arrangement, and your shoes are on the shelf, and the lavatory is over there. So you must make that extra effort to put something on your feet. And number four, definitely don't that. Then following up on that is don't go into the lavatory with your socks, because then you bring those socks, dirty socks, into the masjid, right, or wherever it is, and whatnot. Number four. A person should not undress or uncover his setter except at the last moment. And so this again points to the aspect of privacy and decency, and is necessitated in an act where it can only be carried out by a person uncovering his private parts. And number five, a person, it's good adab after to purify yourself, to make wudu. Right? And, sorry, this is a different point. Purification after is necessary. Because it's not a class of fiqh, I won't explain when there are certain times when a person uses the restroom. Let's say he goes to urinate, where it's wajib to wash, and sometimes it's sunnah to wash. But for our purposes, we'll just say at all times, just wash. Okay? So a person should wash with water, and in our system, we use toilet paper to make sure that that a person is thoroughly cleaned. Now, there is one point that's missing. It comes a bit in the fiqh. One of the things that we should be careful about, this is more fiqh than adab, but they tie in, obviously, is that if you look at the more detailed fiqh books on how to relieve yourself, it says that when a person is finished urinating, he should either cough or make some movement, and some even say walk. But the idea is to completely clear the urethra, right? So that there's no urine in between the bladder and the point of exit. And why is that? Again, because of the wudu. Because you may wash yourself and you think you're clean and you perform wudu, but when you stand up, some drops have come out and you're unaware. So the idea is that you're completely done, and so you wash yourself. It is recommended that after that, when relieving oneself or washing, you not use your right hand. This is in accordance of the Islamic teaching of devoting and confining the use of the right hand to things that are considered good, like eating, shaking hands, etc., holding the Quran, and drinking, while the left hand is considered is used or for those things that are considered not, not so protocoled, like cleaning your nose, washing. We carry our shoes. Someone gives you garbage, we carry it in the left hand. Again, this is not a matter of halal haram, this is a matter of adab and poor adab. So a person, it may be right-handed, and he's carrying his shoes in the right hand and Quran in the left. So it's better, good adab, to carry the shoes, to enter, to wash, right? If you clean your nose, to use your left hand, etc. And seven, though taking care to avoid impurities on the body or clothes and washing afterwards are necessary, exaggeration and obsessive squeamishness in either should also be avoided. So both ways. Not are we to be entirely careless, that we know, but also so particular that a person, you know, he feels almost like dreading to use the restroom, or, you know, making big preparations and whatnot. Number eight, it is indecent. Obviously, these are obvious, you know, if wherever, but sometimes they may not be. And wherever I see, breaches in adab from either students or kids or even adults who are here off, so I'll make note of that. It is indecent for a Muslim to look that it's indecent for Muslims to look at another's private parts. Actually, it's indecent, it's bad adab to look at your own. And also a person's own excretion, you know. And that. And one time, some doctor subs were having some chai, and they were just talking, right? And they said, "Isn't it ajeeb how Allah Subhanahu wa Taala made the human body that the anus is is hidden from our view. Imagine that a person had to look at that. So it's hidden, and whatever comes out from there, and also the area itself is bad adept to look at it, right? Not that a person would look at it for any purpose, but it's just to turn his glance. Now that's a very interesting, because that also points to the adab of us looking away, not from haram things, that's a given, but there are many things that we should, when we come across, we should turn our glance away, even though we're not looking at that thing with any shahwa or desire, okay? It's not inciting anything in us. For example, if we're walking like in these counties, you know, we don't live in a dry state or dry county. So you go to the supermarket and the bread aisle is over here, or the water aisle or drink aisle, and the alcohol is here. So we don't have to look, even though there's no incitement to purchase or to wish for, right? But we should just turn our... So anything that's undesirable, we keep our eyes away. And that is a whole new topic, which won't even come in the adab, is the protection of the eyes, right? And if anyone here has a wife who's expecting, or you know, one of the things that the Islamic book will say, and when you have adab for an expectant mother, is read more Quran and etc. But it will also say that try and keep the mother's gaze always on beautiful things, you know. And I didn't know that. I was a student and I read, and I remember, you know, we lived out and the grass was getting big, and I made it a point that okay, I should keep the grass cut and make sure that my wife had at least some, not like big weeds and a bush to look at, because we don't know something that is hidden. And Allah mentioned this word ghaib right at the onset. Okay, I'm diverging a little bit. Right? الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Ghaib, the hidden. There's a whole world in a dimension that we don't know. And one of the aspects of the ghaib is there's a thing called athar, the effect of the unseen on us. Right? And because we live in such a technological age that unless we see it, we won't believe it. We have to see the video, you know, show us the video, right? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has established right at the beginning, this is a book of guidance for certain class of people. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الْمُتَّقِينَ هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ. I don't know if it'll come it'll probably come in the clothing section, so I'm jumping ahead. But if you look at the adab and the fiqh of clothing, I found it so interesting. It boggles my mind even now that someone asked Imam Hanifa, rahmatullah alayhi, about the wearing of like crocodile skin, you know, shoes and belts and you know, and the skin, once it's tanned, it's clean. But he said that it's makruh, and now we're talking about fiqh. He said it's makruh to wear clothing or shoes or belts from the hide of these types of animals, because the athar can be felt in the wearer. If you want to have that argument, have it with him, rahmatullah alayh. That's his knowledge, right? He's saying, look, you wear crocodile skin, there's some of it will come onto you. This is so we should not, going back, we should not look, because we don't know what is the athar, but rather we should keep our gaze to those things that Allah has created of beauty in this world. Like a smile, that's why you know it's important to smile, because you like to look at it. And on the, well, the whole adab, you know, when you see good adab, you feel that is a good athar. As a mark of respect when you're urinating or relieving oneself, one should not face or turn one back to the Qibla. And again, just so for our own knowledge, right? Because this is ultimately, we want to seek knowledge. If you open the book, like let's say, if you open any of the books of hadith, and it shows you Babul Istinja, the chapter of Istinja, or the hadith of Istinja, it'll come to the hadith on this, facing or turning the Qibla. You know, there are 20 rulings, 20 different opinions given on facing and turning your back towards the Qibla. So we follow the most stringent, meaning that regardless of whether a person is indoors or outdoors, normally with no outdoor relieving anymore, but indoors, meaning the modern day enclosed lavatory, we should not face the Qibla or turn our back towards the Qibla. Okay? Just a simple rule. And try and pay a little bit attention when we go to a place where we don't know, because the Sahaba did do that. When they went and saw the direction that people were facing in Sham, or the way the place of relieving was constructed, they noticed that it was facing towards the Haram or the back. So all they did was just turn a little bit, right? And you know, you may think that this is, like I said, we may take this for granted. I once went to a masjid where they built an imam's residence, and they made built a house from scratch, and they had the toilets back towards the Qibla. And someone had to point it out to them, you know. So as far as possible, as far as possible, even in the homes, you buy a home, so you know, I have to be careful that the back or the front is not facing. Number 10, obviously in terms of posture, the squatting is the best when passing a stool urinating. Standing is completely forbidden, you know, unless a person cannot squat at all, having some issue, you know, with his legs or knees or something like that, as in the case of the elderly. And 11, for a Muslim to talk while relieving himself is considered bad adab. Again, we're not going to talk about haram, makruh, except in the case of, you know, a real need. And likewise, so I know we know that, but one thing we are not knowing so much is that reading also is bad adab. Now that you see, you know, you go to a place, you see the whole stack of magazines. And I don't know, that's not bad adab. And sometimes now it's gone even a step further. Now people have like a TV, you know. And where do we get that from? That I went to a place, whether it was an eating establishment, and they had a TV in the thing. You know, we just can't have enough entertainment. So why not bring that into our own Muslim homes? But it's not permitted. A person goes into this place, does his business, and cleans himself and comes out. If someone greets a Muslim while he's in a state of relieving himself, obviously he shouldn't say anything till he leaves. And then he should apologize or tell him, and then return the greeting. 13, a Muslim should leave the lavatory only after covering his body correctly, obvious. 14, it is recommended that a Muslim does not pass water in the same place that he bathes. That's makruh, and that's because you don't know. Then you start wondering, oh, is my ghusl counted? Just keep the two separate. And on coming out of the lavatory, a Muslim should say, Ghufranak, Alhamdulillah, alladhi adhaba anni al-adha wa afani. Some other aspects, if you do have to go outdoors, gone on a picnic, or you had to stop somewhere, it's bad adab to go into a place where people may use, like the shade, or a pond, or lake, or something like that, or walkway. No one will go, but normally we may go like behind a tree. But if it's a tree that people you see, you know, it's an open field, they may be going there to use the shade, so it's not good adab to go. And that makes sense too. A dwelling, a place that's very windy, things like that. But that makes sense. Number two, in the outdoors, it's also as necessary to conceal yourself. I mean, Sahaba didn't have toilets, but they would go to a far off place and make sure that no one saw them. It is also wise that the ground not be so hard that the splashes come back. So you have to think a little bit, you know, use a little bit of the next chapter he spoke about was postnatal bleeding, what's called nifas. I'll leave that. Chapter number 3 is an actual chapter on cleanliness and purity. A person should know what is impure, what is called najasa. If he knows what is najasa, then he'll be able to protect himself from it. The examples, as we know, are seminal emissions, prostatic fluid, urine, stool, intoxicants, droppings of animals, blood, pus, things like that. Pretty straightforward. I don't normally see people incognizant of what is najis. In the next, he says bathing. or to bath. The cleanliness of a human body is essential for good adab. Person must always be clean. You know, by the way, the other day, I don't know if someone read this, the US government, they contracted some guy, some Muslim-sounding name, and he wrote in one of his papers that hijab is one of the first steps of extremist behavior. And I think they got some backlash from the public. This is kind of, you know, ignorant thing to say in a paper that's presented to the US government. So it reminded me about a friend of mine who was a sergeant, and he came back from Iraq, and he was in Fort Knox when I was in Kentucky. And he went to a seminar that was also presented by the US Army. And you know what the guy, he said, you know, he couldn't help it. And he spoke up so vociferously that they called him to Washington because he had a legitimate complaint. And I said, what happened? He said, you won't believe, this guy came to give a presentation about Islam. And he said that one of the reasons you have to understand that Muslims wash 5-6 times a day is because they're inherently dirty, right? In the countries that they live in, it's filthy, so they have to wash 5 times a day. He didn't mention anything about the salah. And he said, hey, oh, that's what are you talking about? And they had a little bit of back and forth, and then they called him, you know, to Washington, not to reprimand him, but to ask him that, you know, give us your input, because we think that this guy is teaching us about how to understand the Islamic faith and Muslims. And you saying that as a Muslim and as a sergeant, high-ranking officer, that he's talking, you know, nonsense. So I don't know how they sorted that out. Well, bathing and washing is inherent in our good adab. Regardless, remember, our adab have got nothing to do with our social. It's not that. It's not. And by the way, it doesn't mean that you bath every day. It means that when you have the need to cleanse yourself of sweat, perspiration, or to refresh yourself, to smell clean. So a person should bath. There are obviously times when it is wajib, once a week, Jummah, etc. Taking a bath from time to time cures all this, you know. Where a person again should not bath in a public bath. By the way, it happens in some Muslim countries. They go to the public bath, you know, from carry on from before, we should not urinate in the place that we do ghusl in. When washing is obligatory, again, that's straightforward. Everyone knows, especially after there's any emission, seminal emission, or for a woman who has completed the menstrual cycle, or at the end of her postpartum bleeding. Okay, this one I do want to mention, spend a little bit of time. You know, the Muslim bath, what is known as ghusl, is so simple and takes maybe between 3 and 6 minutes. This whole aspect of sitting in the shower for 10-15 minutes is not only is a waste of water, which borders on the makruh, tahrimi, or haram, the wasting of water, but it's really bad adab. You know, a person goes in, and I'm not going to go into the entering, and that's all follows from istinja. Enters the place where he's going to bath, his shower, let's say. And he, firstly, if he's got any najasa, he washes it. And he then washes his hands 3 times, washes his mouth. Then he performs wudu. How long did that take? Because he's already wet, right? So he's performing wudu. Pour water over your right, your left side, whole body. Rub as much as you can. Let's say today we soap ourselves thoroughly and wash off, rinse off, and you're out. And that doesn't take that long at all, you know. So again, use the soap and whatever, you know, body washes you want, makes you smell. It goes towards the principle of smelling good and being thoroughly clean. But wasting water and sitting in the shower for a long period is, again, bad adab. So why I'm saying that is because we may know that, right? But if we go to someone's house or even in our own homes and our children happen to do that, teenagers, you know, and they're not aware, they're just sitting there like as if it's thing that's bad adab. Especially if you go to someone's house, because your host will think, you know, someone may need to use, especially in today's places where we have, you know, like the tub on one section and the urinal on the other. Cleaning certain area of the body where dirt accumulates is necessary. Similarly, maybe distasteful to ear, but it's part of our adab. We must keep our hands, our nails, right, cut properly, on our feet also, you know. And one thing is very, very important, and a parent asked me that, Imam, please, can we have a class for teenagers? They're unaware of this. That the hair of the armpit and the private part areas must be cleaned. This is our way. For whatever reasons, scientifically or medically, it's not that in its place, because this is the teaching of our Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know. And that is so obviously breached when I know some of our youngsters or men are playing basketball or something and they lift up their hands and there's, you know, it's unclean. That already the manifestation of bad adab becomes clear. So part of our cleanliness is not that only we wash from the exterior, right, but that we smell good, etc. But even that there are certain hairs of the body that have to be removed. There's also a certain mustahab method of trimming the nails, by the way, that we start with the right hand, right, and which finger, and similarly the feet also. But I won't go into that right now. Keeping other parts of the body is also clean, is also incumbent of good adab. What does he mean by that? Your head, your hands, your feet. You know, there's I don't know where we get this perception that a person cannot look after his feet or his hands. I have seen, like I said, our own ulama or shuyukh gone to make wudu and come back and ask for cream. And they would cream their feet and look after their hands. And this is part of the good adab. If a person has his feet are cracked, you know, so just take care of them. Because if a time comes and someone looks at you, you feel, okay, this person has looked after himself. Similarly, your beard should be well looked after, not to the point of being obsessive or vain. Just oil to comb, to wash, to keep it not from being disheveled, you know. Your hair is all over the place. If it needs to be cut. And just, I think it will come in the chapter of the hair, but if it doesn't, it's no problem. So Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to have three hair lengths, right? As one time, sometimes it would come to his earlobe, right? Sometimes to the neck, and the longest was to the shoulder. But Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu would keep his hair, like, I don't want to say like mine, but he would keep it very short. And when asked, he said that it facilitates his ghusl. So when he had to make ghusl, so it would be easy to, because that when making ghusl, the hair has to be washed thoroughly up to the roots. So, at the end of the day, a person should keep his hair, beard, his face, etc., looking neat. And again, there's nothing unusual because we do that when we go for interviews or we go for some corporate setting or work environment, hopefully. And so, why not in our daily life, especially when we come for salah? It's not just Friday, you know. Every time we come for salah, and it's one of the habits of our pious predecessors that I've read many times that when they wake up for the tahajjud salah, they would wash thoroughly and they would wear best clothes, like, you know, nice clothing, and they would put itar and wear their topi or kalansua or cap. Or, and when asked, why do you do this like major production at, you know, odd hours? It's just because of presenting ourselves before the Lord of the entire universe. And you know what, you know, so where is our Islam teaching us, right? So anyway, he says, keep yourself and all, especially those parts that I will come in contact with people, right? Your hand, you know, you'll be writing, presenting. So one of the first things you notice is a person's hands, right? So that's why. So, similarly, your face, you know, etc. Special attention should be given, of course, to your oral hygiene, and because it's always the focal point of communication. You always look at the person's mouth and what emanates from it. And in this regard, Obviously, we should use a miswak, but we should also brush regularly, which is a good habit. And that brush regularly means after every meal, so 3 times a day minimally. And you know, I mentioned once before that I used to, my father sent me to a Catholic school, and they used to wake up early. They used to wake up, for them, it was for us Fajr, but they used to wake up at, let's say, 6 o'clock, 5:30. And before breakfast, the whole school, that 600 boys, would go on a walk around the thing. Then they would have breakfast. And when I used to come to school, they were just about finishing their breakfast, 7:30. And I noticed that they had all their toothbrushes lined up, because after breakfast, they would just pick up their toothbrush and brush. And I found it interesting that the oral hygiene followed after every meal, you know? That's one. Two, a person, again, doesn't have to be overly fixated on his mouth. You know, today we have perfect teeth as Allah has given us, but now we want to go for and do a couple of $1,000 procedure to make sure that the smile is completely unblemished. And that's not what Allah has given us. Of course, those foods that are causing our teeth to be stained, you know, coffees and sodas, should be avoided inherently, right? One of the things he did mention, which I mentioned in a khutbah once, is the use of the tooth stick. And someone asked me and I explained to them. Very easy. If you use a toothpick, whatever comes up from the toothpick is good enough to spit that out. But if you use your tongue, then it's sunnah it's better adab to swallow that. So you spit out what came out with the toothpick, but you can swallow what came out when you cleansed your teeth using your own teeth or your gums. And I'll finish in 2 minutes, inshallah, 5 minutes. Any of these methods is not a substitute for the other. They complement each other. This is very interesting. I have actually been in places where I took a toothbrush and someone tried to make it like an act of piety, that of impiety or something, that, oh, why are you not using a miswak? The two are separate. The miswak is a sunnah, a stress sunnah, as well as cleansing. The toothbrush is purely cleansing, though there's an aspect of the sunnah in the cleansing, right? And that's still stuck with me, because you get people who may make you feel that, oh, why are you using the toothbrush? There's a miswak. No, the miswak has its place and will always, because it is a sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. But in today's times, our diet is so filled with things that they never ate even our grandparents haven't seen, right? Our diet is filled with especially sugar and acidic foods, that we have to engage in a regimen of good oral hygiene. It's important. Toothpaste. The Prophet ﷺ didn't use toothpaste. We can't come today and say, oh, Nabi ﷺ didn't use toothpaste. Why are you using toothpaste? Because it goes to the overall adab of good oral hygiene and oral health. Another is that there were certain foods that the Prophet ﷺ used to avoid. And that's not just because the consequence of those eating those would be a bad odor, but the angels like to gather around the mouth when a person is doing dhikr or especially reading the Quran. And again, that's one of the ghaib. We don't know that, so they don't like garlic and onion, we'll say curry, and you know, all those flavors coming out from the mouth. So that's why a person eats them, fine. Then he'll clean thoroughly, then he'll pick up the Quran and he'll read. Now, why do I say that? Because especially in Ramadan, you know, we notice very clearly that, especially in the salah, between burping and, you know, speech, we notice people have eaten something and they have not cleaned properly. So it's bad adab. So at least minimally, we have learned this, so we should try and be more particular about that. You know what? I'll stop here, inshallah. Any of these methods, it is difficult, and it is difficult in practical care. Toothbrush, yeah, sure, but you can keep your miswak in your pocket or in your workplace, have those little containers where the toothbrush is kept. Of course, on a journey, you'll keep your thing. You travel, you keep your little toothbrush and whatnot. and even give you, in addition to miswak, you know, when meeting someone, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to always keep himself clean. Next week, inshallah, he'll talk about something interesting for us, the cosmetics and adornment for men. Yes, it's not just women who think. Abu Dharr radiallahu ta'ala used to wear and dress up, make up himself. And they asked him why. He says, I make myself up for my wife as she does for me. She also is making herself up and she wears nice clothes. So next week's chapter is about the cosmetics and adornment for man. Yes, we're not talking about GQ adornment, our own Islamic adab. So inshallah, we'll stop there. And if you have any questions, you can either ask me now or when you're having our chai, inshallah. Let's make a small dua. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت السميع العليم اللهم اجعلنا من التوابين واجعلنا من المتطهرين ولا تجعلنا من قوم الجاهلين اللهم أنت السلام ومنك السلام تبارك يا ذا الجلال والإكرام برحمتك يا رب.